but our houses are falling apart. Because our hearts are rusted. But when God begins to say, you really want me to restore you? You really want me to change you? I'm going to scrub. I'm going to scrub. And I'm going to buff. And I'm going to rub you the wrong way. And I'm going to do this. And I'm going to do that. And it's going to burn you. And it's going to hurt you. But when you come out of the fire, you're coming out like gold. And you're beginning to look something like that. That's what you should be looking like. That's what you want. You want a new heart. You want a new me. Why? Because out of the heart comes preach. Gotta keep going. I find it interesting, and I read it on financial. People just say, well, I just pray about it. Well, I don't care how old you are, you pray all you want. That rusty engine is staying rusty until you put your butt in it and do what you gotta do. Restoration does not start with God. I want to say that again. Restoration does not start with God. It starts with you and finishes with Him. Please understand that, church. Please understand that. Don't be fooled. Don't let religion tell you otherwise. That if you just get $20 in the offering bucket, everything's going to be okay. That if you raise your hand a certain height, it's going to be fine. That if you wore a dress to church or look a certain way. Honey, that's nonsense. Christianity and the Bible shows me that relationship, that as long as I have a good relationship with Him, the closer that I get to Him, that's when the stains begin to come off. That's when all the ugliness begins to come off. But it takes process. Then I gotta keep going. Verse 14. Then I went to the fountain gate and to the king's pool, but my donkey couldn't get through the rubble. Verse 15. So though it was still dark, I went up to Kidron Valley instead, inspecting the wall before I turned back and entered again at the valley gate. The city officials did not know I had been out there or what I was doing, for I had not yet said anything. Notice he's still quiet to anyone about my plan. I had not yet spoken to the Jewish leaders, the priests, the nobles, the officials, or anyone else in the administration. Notice, he's not talking about just friends or people. He's talking about priests, nobles, and officials. He hasn't said a word. And here's this guy, Nehemiah, just walking in there, a weeping prophet, was known as the weeping prophet because he always cried. He's just walking into a place and says, I'm going to get ready to restore this place. And people are like, what the heck are you doing? What is this guy doing here? Now watch what it goes on to say in verse 17. But now I said to them, you know very well what trouble we are in. Jerusalem lies in ruins. How many of you know that our houses lie in ruins? Our finances lie in ruins. Our relationships right now lie in ruins. And then it goes on to say, and if it have been destroyed by fire, let us rebuild the wall of Jerusalem and end this disgrace. I hope someone can say to you, you know what? Let us rebuild our marriage. Let us restore our finances. Let us refill our situation, whatever it may be. Then it goes on to say, then it goes up to verse 18. Then I told them about how gracious hand of God had been on me and about my conversation with the king. They replied at once, yes, let's rebuild the wall. So they began the good work. Verse 19. But when Sanballat and Tobiah and Geshem and the Arab heard all the plans, they scoffed contemptuously. What are you all doing? Are you rebelling against the king? They asked. Verse 20. I replied, the God of heaven will help us succeed. We, his servants, will start rebuilding this wall. But you have no share, no legal right, or historic claim in Jerusalem. I've got news for you. When you begin to have restoration in your life and start to do what you need to do, people are going to oppose what you're doing. You got to hear this. People are going to oppose what you're doing. And he clearly and calmly says, you all have no legal right, you have no share, and you have no historic claim in Jerusalem. Paraphrasing, he says, get your butt out of my business because it has nothing to do with you. This is my marriage. This is not your marriage. This is my family. This is not your family. This is the wall that God called me to rebuild. This is not your wall. You go play with Legos, but I got to do what I got to do. But if you're going to get in my way, get the heck out of my way because I got plans for you. Don't be afraid to tell people that, but people have no business in your business. They need to be thrown out of your business. Now, I'm not going to read out of Nehemiah 3 because it's such a long chapter, but I want you to see the next part of restoration. Watch what it says, verse 1. Then he issued it to the highest priest, and the other priest started to rebuild where? The sheep gate. Now, watch what it says in verse 3. The fish gate, it says, was built by who? The sons of Hasena. Now watch what it says in verse 6. The old city gate was repaired by Joiada. Now watch what it says in verse 13. The valley gate was repaired by the people from Zenoa. Now, I'm just stopping right there, but if you read chapter 3, it begins to tell you who's doing what. It begins to tell you, this person is rebuilding this gate, this person is rebuilding this gate. Every gate has a meaning. I do not have time right now to preach the meaning of each gate, which is very powerful. Maybe I'll get to it the rest of this year. But every gate had a purpose. What I want you to understand about restoration is that restoration requires organization. I'm going to say that again. God is a God of order. He is not a God of disorder. You cannot do whatever you want to do, whatever you feel like doing. God is the restorer, and He will tell you exactly what you need to do, when you need to do it. So your focus and your focal point should be listening to His vision. Listening to His voice, so He can give you a clear vision of what you need to do. Because what happens, we will come in and say, oh, well, it's like house remodeling. Well, I think that the chair looks better over here. And the wife says, no, but the chair looks better over here. No, but the cable TV's over here. No, but the box looks better over here. And we begin to argue. When God said, I wanted the chair here, I wasn't asking you how you felt about it. You hear what I'm saying? We question and we ask too many questions. When God tells you to do something, just do it. Just simply do. Number one, it requires organization. You have to have the pieces in place. You would not restore a car with missing pieces. You would not say, well, I'm just going to get a 67 Chevy and mix it with a 92 Camaro and put some truck parts in. You're going to have a capirotada. For my white friend, that's capirotada. Hey, that's terrible. You cannot have that. In fact, what I like about what people do when they restore cars is that they begin to put all the parts in order. They break them up. They lay them out, smallest to biggest, in the order that they're getting ready to be placed in. There is process. There is organization. There's not a box full of nuts. Let's just see this one work. You don't do that. The car will fall apart. Doesn't work that way. Restoration requires precision. Restoration requires organization. But restoration also, watch this, requires everyone to do their part. I'm going to say that again. Restoration requires everyone to do their part. Notice this. Nehemiah said, okay, this is what God has called to do. We're going to rebuild this wall. But Nehemiah doesn't do it all by himself. In fact, he says, I'm going to take care of this gate. But you are going to do this gate. And you are going to do that gate. So on and so forth. He delegates the restoration phase. Please understand this, church. In marriages, in relationships, this is error number one. Sometimes we try to repair something that someone else should be repairing. Oh, you're not hearing me, church. Sometimes error number one that we make is that we try to restore a part, or we try to restore an area where that person should be the one restoring it. Why? Because they're the one that did the damage. No, it's okay. I'll help you. No, it wasn't that. It wasn't like that. Nehemiah said, no, you go there and you stay there. You focus on that part. I don't need you to come over here. I already got somebody doing this part. But it's interesting to me that us Hispanics, I'm not going to talk about the white and the black folk, but I'm talking about the Hispanic, we have to butt into everybody's business. And I don't know about you, but if I were you, this is the way I would do it. I would have left his sorry butt. How many times have you been married? 7 going on 8. You're asking the wrong person. Restoration, be careful. And so we've got to put people in place and let them do what they need to do. Now watch this. We make the mistake, like I said, of trying to repair something else. Like, for instance, trust. I'll give you an example of trust. Someone breaks trust in a relationship. You know what we try to do? The Christian thing, or something we call it? Forgive them. Well, you're supposed to forgive. True or not true? Yes. Forgiveness is a command. Forgiveness is not what you think, how you feel, do they deserve it, do they not deserve it? You deserve God's grace that God gave it to you. Forgiveness is a command, but trust has to be earned. You hear what I'm saying? And so we got to understand that if restoration needs to take place in a relationship, you can't just say, okay, I take it back, come back in. It don't work that way. You work your way back in. You trust and do. That's not going to work. That they don't want to be restored. That's what I told you about restoration. In order for it to work, it's got to cost you. If it's free, if it's painless, it won't mean anything to you. You'll go back to square one. Church, this is not the sermon people don't want to hear. That's why I'm not hearing many amens. But it's the truth. You won't want to preach 2014, the year of prosperity, that if you just show up to church, you're going to grow a garden of money in your house. Baloney, I won't preach that. I will not preach that. I won't preach the truth, and I said it before. If we go from 1,000 back to 400 preaching the truth, let it be that way. Because I'm not going to die through or put through the word of God. This is the word of God. And everybody has access to his grace. Everybody has access to his blessing. But nobody is exempt. Not even me. We got to follow God's way or your highway. I'm going to teach you. Amen. All right. Don't get mad at me. Get mad at me. Watch this, error number two. We try to help. And we don't let people do the things on their... Let me help you do the wall. I know how to do it. This happens a lot in families. This happens a lot in churches. Well, you know, I need you to clean your room. And then the kid goes clean the room. I will not let that clean it like this. No, let him. I need you to wash the car. I need you to clean this. I need you to go there. I need you... Can you put up this... just put up the tree. Can you put up that? Can you do that? We make the mistake of butting in. And then you wonder why the husband or the spouse doesn't want to do anything. Because it's not your way. Look, if you say for the trash to go out, does it really matter how I take the trash out? Oh, y'all not hear what I'm saying, church. Some of you are like, oh, talk to him, Pastor. That's what I want to hear. If you tell me to take the trash out, then it doesn't matter if I go from room 1 to room 2 to living room to bedroom 1 to bedroom 2 to bathroom 1 to bathroom. I may go through any one that I want, any order that I want, but the trash is going to go out. We got to let people do things the way they need to do it. Don't try to change, manipulate, and control. Are y'all not hearing what I'm saying, church? See, the reason why we don't have restoration in reality, it's like a baby learning to walk. Come on, you need to get up to walk. And then they're getting ready to fall, right? You know how they are in the middle. You know how they are, y'all crazy. And then they fall. Ah! Of course, when you have your second, third, and fourth eye, because I'm out there. But my point of what I'm trying to say, Balcony, what I'm trying to say, church, is that we have to allow the baby to try to get up and let him fall. Ah, church, you won't hear this anywhere, I'm telling you. I'm telling you, if you keep helping the baby up, he'll always depend on you. But if you let the baby go up, even if he looks like a kangaroo and he falls to the floor, he'll get back up and he'll have a little bit of strength and he'll have a little broken down. He might even hurt his head, but he'll be able to walk. We have decapitated our family, our relationship, because we don't let the other person fall. Oh, God. Church, you better be taking this in. Hi, Pastor, but it hurts. Of course it hurts. It's a fall. It's going to hurt. But it's not going to kill you. Oh, I got to keep going. Watch what happens. No, remember what I talked about opposition. Nehemiah 4, 1 and 2. Sanballat was very angry when he learned that there was the rebuilding of the wall. He flew into a rage and mocked the Jews. Verse 2, saying in front of his friends and the Samaritan officers, what is this bunch of poor Mexican feeble Jews, okay, doesn't say Mexican, I had it, think they're doing? Do they think they can rebuild a wall in a single day without a Lowe's or a Home Depot by just offering a few sacrifices? Do they actually think that they can make something of stones from rubbish, heap, and charred ones at that? I'm telling you right now, when restoration begins, you will meet opposition. You will meet opposition. Your family will come against you, and you're just the same people I'm trying to restore with. They're going to come against you because they're not going to like what you're trying to do. Why? Because restoration gets you out of your comfort zone. You were comfortable with the way things were. You were comfortable with things being tight. You were comfortable with things being uncomfortable. Ah, it's all right. Leave it alone. We'll just deal with it. That's just the way we are. But God says, I want to restore you to me. And that means I'm going to have to shake you and move you and break you a little bit and get you out of your comfort zone so that you can see a new thing. Don't be like the Israelites that were in slavery for many years. And then they thought paradise was the desert. And they got stuck in the desert because they thought, well, this is great. This is all that we have. God says, I'm taking you to the promised land, don't you see? But they were stuck in circles in the desert. Why? They thought that was the end. It was better than where they were. You may be